You too at home. Hello. Welcome to Living Waters Fellowship Church. And I want you to know that the Holy Spirit is on fire and here this morning. Join me in prayer, please. Father, oh Father, we thank you so much for this day. The anointing upon our pastor, the anointing upon this church and our congregation, both here and at home. Father, pour out your Spirit. Open our hearts and minds. Let the words of our pastor bring forth your will, Lord God. And I pray the message that we're going to share today touches the families, the men and women who serve you. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm. That carries out his word. They rush on the city, they run on the wall. Great is the army that carries out his word. The Lord utters his voice before his army. The Lord utters his voice before his army. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Blow the trumpet.
I'm forever grateful that your amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul, I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. And there's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is I will rise when you
I'll pick the mic up this time. Church, those of you watching at home, if you don't see it on my face, hear it in my voice, or you can't feel it, the Holy Spirit is moving in a mighty, mighty, mighty way. An anointing is on here, on this church, and it's going to explode very shortly. The message that Pastor has for us today is incredible. And you need to hear it. Hear it in your heart. Pray that God opens your heart and mind for this. And the message coming next week will blow your socks off. Father, we just thank you so much for gathering us as a family. Each and every one of us, our focus is on you, Father God. And the sacrifice that your Son so freely gave for our lives, our sins. Please bless us, Father God. Bless this service. Anoint this service for each of us here in this sanctuary and at home, Father God. Touch our hearts. You're coming in a mighty way, and you're coming soon. Father, we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand up and greet somebody.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Living Waters Fellowship. We are a spiritual oasis in the middle of the desert, a place where God's healing waters flow. Our church is based on three pillars: evangelism, each one reach one; discipleship, building up the house of God in every person; and our mission is to make a difference in our community and the world for Christ. If You're here for the first time, we give you a big welcome. Thank you for coming, and please let us know if there's any need that you have that we can help you meet. We do have a biblical maxim we repeat together. Please join me. We are mighty men and women of valor because we are greater in the eyes of God than we are in our own eyes. And while our hearts may condemn us, God is greater than our hearts and knows what truly lies within. Taken from Judges 6 and 1 John 3. We'd like to remind you to please turn off your cell phones, and if our ushers would come forward, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we are able to give back to you just a portion of what you have given to us, Father. Help us to give it with a joyful heart and to give us wisdom in how you would have us use what you've provided for us. Amen. And if you're watching on this, you can send your tithe to our physical address, 211 West 1st South, Suite C, Mesquite, 89027. Our box is 3294, that zip code's 89127. And we always encourage you to visit our webpage at mesquitelivingwaters.com. Please remember, we always have a prayer team that comes up after the service. We'll be up front to pray for you. We have Wednesday night Bible studies at 6 o'clock. The women are going through John's New Testament letters, and the men are studying The Measure of a Man. So please join us Wednesday night at 6 for the Bible studies. And we will have corporate prayer this Thursday. James, do you want to share?
Do you want to say a couple of words?
Well, a couple. Just a couple.
I could be
See you in an hour. Oh.
It's the next Sunday already. No, I just want to piggyback what Moose was saying about the Holy Spirit wanting to touch us. He wants to move in this congregation. I honestly believe that. And will we allow him to do it? Will we open our hearts to him? There's so many, I was talking with Pastor Dennis on Thursday, there's so many distractions in the world right now. We need to keep Jesus as the center of our life. Amen? And that's not always easy. We know that. I'm kind of a black and white person. I say, well, keep him in the center. I know, but then I'll watch this, and then I'll watch that, and then somebody will say this, and somebody will say that. And it's like, oh, Lord. That old saying, nip it in the bud. When people are starting to talk about the world and all its garbage going on, just say, Jesus, help me. That he would stay the center. And part of staying in the center is our corporate praise and prayer that we have twice a month. And I'll tell you right now, we've had a good turnout, and there's been people, everyone that's come in has left recharged. The tank is full. Holy Spirit is touching people's lives. People are kneeling. People are raising hands. We're just worshiping and praising God. And praise is the highway to the heart of God. When he hears us praising him and worshiping him, his ear comes over and goes, who's this? I'll tell you, it is really powerful. And I think if you've mentioned to anybody here, if you were to talk to anybody that's been here, they would say the same thing. And like when Moose was saying about how the Holy Spirit's moving that, and you can't maybe see it in that, but the feeling, you sense it. That's what happens on Thursdays during our corporate praise and prayer. And we start at 6 o'clock this Thursday. I said it would go probably till 7, a little bit after. I know the last one was about an hour and a half. But you know what? I always say, if you need to leave, go ahead. But no one leaves. Everybody's just full on and just worshiping. It's amazing. It's amazing when we open up our hearts. So, you know, if you can make it, great. If not, I understand. But I just wanted to make the announcement. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, James. Tonight, Sunday night service, 6 o'clock, Pastor Mike is teaching from Psalm 31, so join us at 6. And put on your calendar, our next potluck will be Sunday, February 13th. It's a special potluck. I know it's Super Bowl Sunday, but the game doesn't start till 3 or 4, so you can come, have a little fellowship, and your belly will be full, and then you can just be the couch potato and root for your team or boo the other team, whatever. But stay for the potluck. So that's the 13th. So I think that covers everything. As we go to prayer, you know, we all read verses and then you read them again and it's something else. But the Lord laid on my heart again Psalm 118:24, which we all know, that says, "This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." We will. We will. So today is priceless. There will never be another day like this. So whatever the day holds, we can choose to see the blessings of the day or we can dwell on the bad. So, Lord, as we come before you today, help us to focus on the gladness and the joy we find in you. We can face all challenges if our focus is on you. We come rejoicing to hear your word. So we please ask you to anoint every word that Pastor Dennis and Pastor Mike have for us this Sunday, because we know they are for us and we need to hear them. Amen.
Yeah. Before we start, we're going to have a special announcement. And where's Sharon? Will you please come forward? She always wants to stand down there.
Yeah. She listens.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Jeff. Before I start, I want to read this out of Habakkuk 2:2. It says this. He says, "Write the vision down." This is the Lord speaking to Habakkuk. He says, "Write the vision down, make it plain to read, so that those who hear it will run with it." This was regarding a vision that God had given to Habakkuk. He said, the vision isn't for right now. It's going to come later, but it will come. So he says, write the vision down. So I want to share a vision that the Lord gave me on Monday. Let me pray. Father in heaven, again, we do come before you. I pray that you would just go before us, Lord God. Give us ears to hear truly what your spirit would say to each one of us, Father. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I'm going to read it to you. "I saw in a vision the backside of the Lord as he was walking. And I felt like I was just standing there and he was before me and he was walking and he had his head down. And I got to tell you, this is very, very serious. He had his head kind of down. And he spoke this. He said, this is enough. He wasn't speaking that so much to me. He just said it. And then he kind of turned his head like this. He didn't point to me or anything, but just kind of turned his head as I was back there. And he said, I want you to pray a full 24 hours, specifically for Michaela." Hallelujah. Now, Michaela is Pastor Dennis's wife, and she has been sick for almost 5 years. So, then I saw a group. All of a sudden, I was here, and I saw a group of people standing. No one in particular, just a group of people. After pondering and praying, I believe the church is to be involved. So Thursday, I met with Pastor Dennis, of course, my husband, Barb and Jim, and we were praying. And I brought it up after we were praying. The Lord actually reminded me of it. And so as I shared this, Pastor asked me to share it from the pulpit. That's why I'm here. Friday morning, that was on a Thursday night. Friday morning when I got up, I was praying, and I was asking the Lord, you know, how do you want me to do this, da, 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 you know, all the questions. And what I saw was a chain-link fence of prayer surrounding Michaela. It wasn't a real tall fence. It was just a fence. But it was chain-link. It was a chain-link. So they were all connected. And I feel that's what he wants us to do for Michaela, is lock arms in prayer around her for a full 24 hours. So I'm not going to ask all of you guys to pray 24 hours, but what we're doing is we have a list like this, and it's on the table right over there, and we have something starting. It's going to start tonight at 12:01 a.m. to pray for Michaela for 1 hour. Now, I know for some that might be a little tough, but you know what? It'll go by really fast, and the blessing will be for you too. So it starts at 12:01 a.m., and it ends tomorrow at 12:01. So if you would, I would like you guys to sign your name, those who feel called to this, and that you would make that commitment for Michaela, because I do believe that God wants to us to see this great thing that he is going to do before our eyes. Okay? Tonight at 12:01. The sign-up sheets are over there, and it's only for 1 hour. Then what we'll have you do is call the next person in line, and then they'll pick it up from there, from 1 to 2. And then they'll call the next person from 2 to 3. And it'll go a full 24 hours all the way around. And it's for healing for Michaela, to pray for her healing on the inside, on the outside, spiritually, not only physically, but spiritually, mentally, socially, in every way possible. You know, I heard someone pray one time, and he said, you know, we always pray, Lord, protect us from the elements out there. But you know what? We need to also pray for the elements that are already in us, right? Okay, so we're going to pray every way possible, and God will give you the words to pray. As you're obedient to do that, God will give you the words to pray, and whatever comes to your mind, just start praying it for Michaela. Okay, so with this... So with this, I would like to ask each of you and invite you to join with us in battle for our sister. Now remember that no one goes to battle when we're really fighting in prayer. We're fighting a battle. So remember, no one goes to battle without their armor on. Military people, when they're called out to go, they are fully equipped. So, brothers and sisters, prayer warriors and intercessors, let's go to work. Amen? Thank you. You heard him.
Pastor Mike, you need to give her a raise. I know that many of you know, but actually don't know, but just no one can figure out what's going on with her. Doctors can't. Medical professionals can't. Some medical professionals won't even come in and see her. And so this has been very discouraging for her. And so this is, and even this morning she was hoping maybe to come in, and she was really, really bad. So... I appreciate that. That's a blessing. But just to let you know, you're going to be joining in with some other people. This prayer request went out to Promise Keepers this morning. They're already praying around the United States and beyond.
Thank you.
It's gone to the head of the Promise Keepers, and he's going to get it to all the prayer chains of the Promise Keepers. So this is not something that's just... And this is something directed by God. And Heavenly Father, I come before you now. And I just ask that you would have your way. And Lord, that you would bring that healing touch. The reason behind it, I don't know. But Lord, you know. Because you are the great physician. So Lord, I'm asking that you would do this. Thank you for bringing us all here today. And Lord, I ask that you would give us ears to hear what it is that you are speaking to the church. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Debbie, you can go to the next slide. Today, I want to talk to you about, I call it a warning given. When it comes to warning, we have all sorts of warnings, a whole bunch of systems out there that basically warn us of impending danger. We have what is known as the public alert and early warning systems that are there, kind of like the DEFCON level warning system that warns us of potential nuclear attacks. There's also what's called the North warning system, which is an early warning radar system for potential air attacks over all of North America. In fact, we're hearing warnings from almost every sector of our society. We have health warnings, like those around surrounding this current pandemic that is going on around the globe. But also, more than that, of potential outbreaks. You hear of all these potential outbreaks, and so there's these warnings going out, not only here in America, but throughout the world. We also have a variety of weather and natural disaster warnings, like earthquakes, hurricanes, tornadoes, flash floods, tsunamis, excessive heat, and excessive cold warnings. We also have various warnings around the world alerting people to potential of war, or of terrorist attack, or of nuclear or biological warfare warnings. There's also economic warnings as well, like the inflation rate or bull or bear market, international geopolitical relationships, that's what they call it, trade and supply deficits and surpluses. We got all these different warnings, and they help to protect us from physical and economic harm. But my thought was, what about our spiritual lives? What sort of warning is there out there for our own spiritual lives to protect us from the ravages of sin and of Satan? And just so you don't get discouraged, God has set up a warning system. He has set it up through his prophets, his preachers and teachers to get the word out, which comes directly out of the word, the Bible. And these warnings not only get our lives right with the Lord God, the warnings are helping us to get our lives right with God, but I also find out this as well, as that is, there's also from God's word these warnings about the end of days, the end of the world, basically, the end of the world warnings that are out there, the last days. Now, if I could give a summary statement on what we'll be talking about today, I would do it this way. A warning given, a warning taken, a deliverance achieved. Now, the Bible records many warnings throughout its pages. Those who heeded these warnings were spared the predicted consequences, and they achieved the deliverance. But those who did not listen, the consequences of not listening. But I want to consider one person right now that basically all this is wrapped up in. Everything I've talked about up to this particular point, and that's Noah. God warned Noah and his family of the coming flood and directed them how to prepare an ark in order to survive it. The warning God gave to Noah was to make himself an ark in order to save his family and every living creature that lives upon the earth. It says in Genesis 6:17, he said, "Behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh in which is the breath of life. Everything that is on the earth shall die." That was God's warning. And so, just as everyone might know, I just need to get this cleared out. I'm not talking about a fairy tale here. The story of Noah and the flood is not a fairy tale. It has been proven. Throughout the globe, there is what is known as the geological strata. There's a strata no matter where you are, South Pole, North Pole, North America, South America, Africa, Europe, Asia, that same strata all over the world, that same strata, they have found evidence of a flood. This was a worldwide flood. This is not a fairy tale. So this was the warning that God had given. Now, listen to God. And so Noah listened to God. He took the warning to heart. And it says this in Genesis 6:22. He did according to all that God commanded him. Hence the warning taken. And because Noah listened to the warning and obeyed the command of God, he and his household, along with the remnant of all living creatures here upon the earth, survived the floodwaters that covered the earth. And it says this in Genesis 8:1. Then God remembered Noah and every living thing, and all the animals that were with him on the ark. Hence, the deliverance achieved. Now look at what the writer of Hebrews, how he describes this event. He said, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of the things not yet seen, or seen not seen yet as yet, that is the warning that was given, he moved with fear, that is, he moved with reverence toward God, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. Hence, the warning taken. By which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. Hence, the deliverance achieved. But even further, the story of Noah reveals God's warning for the end days. Remember I talked about the warnings toward the end days? This was one of the major warnings in which Jesus gave. It was this very warning that Jesus gave to those who are in the last days and the consequences if they ignore the warning before it's too late. Look what he said in Matthew 24. For as in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage up to the day of Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them away, all away. And they say, well, see, they didn't even know. Yes, they did. For over 100 years, Noah was preaching it. He was called a preacher of righteousness. You don't get the title of preacher unless you're doing it. He preached righteousness to everyone. Everyone knew. I'm going to get excited here. I don't even know where I am. And so throughout God's word, we see it time and again where God warns the people of coming judgment. And basically, it's up to every person whether or not they're going to accept the warning, whether they're going to hear it, prepare for it, and then look forward to either God's deliverance in and through it, or the other side of it, which is far worse, the experience of consequences that are associated with disobedience. However, the area of scripture that got me thinking about this whole thing was God's call for his people to be watchmen. And when they could see the trouble coming, they were to see the enemy advancing, then they were to blow the trumpet to warn the people. And then it was up to the people whether or not they were going to take the warning. It wasn't up to the watchman to go say, you know, smack him upside the head. Will you hear this? No, he was to speak it. Now it's everybody's responsibilities whether or not they're going to accept the warning or to ignore it. And what got my attention was what the Lord said through the prophet Ezekiel in the 33rd chapter. Look at it with me if you would. This is the signature verse of what we're talking about. When the watchman sees the enemy coming, he sounds the alarm to warn the people. Then if those who hear the alarm refuse to take action, it's their own fault if they die. If they had listened to the warning, they could have saved their lives. Hence, the overall summary, a warning given, a warning taken, a deliverance achieved. Let's look at this first one, this first aspect, a warning given. That's found in Ezekiel 33, verse 3. It says, when the watchman sees the enemy coming, he sounds the alarm to warn the people. It was the sound of the trumpet, the sound of the shofar, that the watchman was the sound to warn the people. In fact, the sound of the trumpet was instrumental within the life of Israel itself. We see this about this particular aspect in Numbers chapter 10, verse 9. He said, when you go to war in your land against the enemy who oppresses you, then you shall sound the alarm with trumpets, and you'll be remembered before the Lord your God, and you'll be saved from your enemies. But the sound of the trumpet was also used within the life of Israel, all of it, including the religious life, as he goes on to say this in verse 10. Also, in the day of your gladness, in your appointed feast, at the beginning of your months, you shall blow the trumpets over the burnt offerings and over the sacrifices for your peace offering. And they shall be a memorial for you before the Lord. And I love it. I am the Lord God. Like we didn't know.
He said, I just want to let you know something. I am the Lord. And this is what I'm telling you to do. And he had to, I love that, he repeated, and I am the Lord God. This is also the sound of the trumpet that God's going to usher in the last days as well, as he gathers his people. We see that going back to Matthew 24 and verse 21, Jesus said, and he will send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. And then concerning the rapture, Paul said this, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. That's 2 Corinthians 15:52. Now, how is this warning being given to us today? How is it being given? I'm going to share with you three things. First, through God's word. Jesus said, there is a judge for the one who rejects me and does not accept my words. The very words I have spoken will condemn them at the last days. And then the warning Jesus gives is that of sin and an eternal death. That is sin and eternal death outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ, outside of a relationship with himself. And Jesus gives us this warning. He said, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. If you want to see the kingdom of God, he's saying, you must be born again. How does one become born again? Jesus said so. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And I've talked about this before. He made this personal. He didn't say religion is what gets you into heaven. He didn't say following rules and regulations is what's going to get you into heaven. He didn't say good deeds are what's going to get you into heaven. What he said, if you want to see the kingdom of God, if you want to get into heaven, then I am the only way. And so the warning is simple. Outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ, there is no eternal life in the presence of God in heaven. But the Bible also gives us a warning concerning the end of days as well and our need to prepare. Jesus said, Luke 21, he said, watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. And again, Matthew 24, he's talking about it again. He said, watch therefore, for you do not know the hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known that hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Now, there are many signs and prophecies given throughout God's word concerning the last days, the end of days of Jesus' return. Some of these are what's known as signs of the times. You've probably heard of that statement, signs of the times. Well, Jesus talked about a lot of them there in Matthew 24. You've heard of some of them, but he talked about false messiahs and prophets that are going to be coming up, wars and rumors of wars, famine, pestilence, earthquakes, and then he likens all these signs to a woman about ready to give birth, a woman in labor pains. And what that says is that all these signs are going to come closer and closer together with greater and greater and greater intensity. Now, besides the word of God, there are two additional methods that God uses. And it all surrounds the word of God itself. But he uses to make sure that we get the warning. The first one I'd like to talk to you about is through preachers and teachers. Romans 10:14 says, how then can they call upon the one that they have not believed in? And how can they believe in one in whom they've not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? God has prepared and basically has called for preachers and teachers to give his word. In other words, to be faithful to bringing out the whole of his word. Not just those parts that we want to hear. You know, I realize this is as I'm reading God's word, there's a lot of things in there that's not really pleasant to hear, is there? He's talking about consequences. He's talking about sin. He's talking about what happens. He's talking about the curses when we disobey God. All these things he's talking about. I remember some people, it wasn't so much here, but in Vegas, I remember sometimes people would come up to me and says, Dennis, you need to give more positive messages. Thought that's what I was doing. Oh, I see.
God's word is his word, and it's going to go forth the way he wants it to go forth. What he has called for me and his preachers and teachers to do is to teach it and to warn the people, to be those watchmen on the tower, to warn. And then the Holy Spirit is the one who then speaks it into our lives. Amen. I'll get to that in a second. I'm going ahead of myself. Now, the Apostle Paul of his mission says this. And I love what he says in Colossians 1:28. He said, him, that is Jesus, we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom that he may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. That is what we are supposed to be doing. But he also said this in 2 Corinthians 5:11, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. That doesn't sound like a very positive thing, is it? Terror of the Lord. Ooh, hello. That's what he says. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, he goes, we persuade men. We need to be able to speak the word because there's only so many years we have here upon this earth and we don't know when they're over. But when our time is here, it's over here upon the earth, there is eternity. There's not a coming back over again. I don't know about you. I don't want to come back again. Do any of you want to come back to this again? Do any of you want to go through puberty again? I don't think so. Oh, some of you really know that one. Okay. And so through faithful preachers and teachers, God's word is sounding that alarm. And when I think about that, I always like what Paul did. I always go back to Paul when he was in Caesarea, when he was in jail for over 2 years. Went through two Roman governors, and the second Roman governor that came was named Festus. And Festus had no idea what to do with this guy. None. He's supposed to send him to Caesar, but he didn't know what to write about him. He didn't understand one thing he was saying. And so, you know, in fact, he really didn't, Paul tried to talk to him one time. He says, get out. Didn't talk to him again. About a year later, King Agrippa comes on in from Judea. And so he comes on in, and they know each other or whatever. And so he said, you know what? I got this guy in prison here. And I haven't the faintest idea what I'm supposed to write about him. Will you listen to him? Let him talk and listen to him so you can tell me what I'm supposed to write? So they invited Paul up. And so Paul preached the gospel message in telling them of their need to repent as well. At the end of it, Festus looked at him and said, boy, you're mad. You know, you're delusional. You got problems. But King Agrippa basically said, Paul, you almost persuade me to be a Christian. We need to get the word out. Lastly, the last one I want to talk to you about is we get the warnings through the Holy Spirit. It is through the promptings of the Holy Spirit that a person becomes convicted and thus warned of their plight. The Apostle Peter said concerning those who spoke forth God's word, who wrote God's word down, he said, for prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. But it was Jesus who made it plain, the purpose of the Holy Spirit's coming. He said, this is the purpose of the Holy Spirit's coming. And when he, that is the Holy Spirit, has come, he'll convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. It's the Holy Spirit that opens up God's word to us that we would hear it and then be able to see what it is that God is speaking to us. And we talk about that so often. In fact, the scripture says, he who has ears to hear what the Holy Spirit is speaking to the church. The Holy Spirit convicts us and he shows us the way. So it all comes down to, will we take the warning? And so the gauntlet has been thrown down. The warning has been given. The question then becomes, will it be taken? Will it be taken? And let me just say this as we go along. My prayer is that the Holy Spirit would speak with every one of you. What has God been saying to you? What has God been telling you? So now I want to get to the second part, and that is a warning taken. At this point, I'd like to give a warning from God's word and see how God's church has so far responded to the warning from God's word. Paul, in his letter to the Roman church, specifically chapter 1, lists out a whole slew of sins. And he begins with the sin of homosexuality. And he said that they didn't like to retain God in their knowledge, and so God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things that were not right. But the very end of chapter 1, He points to the fact and saying, you know what? Not only those, you may not agree with it, you may not be in that sin, but are you approving of it by not saying anything about it? By not acting upon what you know is true? Romans 1:32, he said this, who knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice those things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. If we keep silent, if we allow things to continue on, then we are as guilty as the people that are perpetrating them. And that's what he is saying. There's something, you just say, right now, the question is how and where will we stand? I talked about this the other day with some people about how the church itself is divided. And you have one church against another, one denomination against another denomination, but you have the division happening within the denominations themselves. Right now, there are denominations that have basically said that homosexuality, transgenderism, and all the rest of it is no longer a sin. It's no longer a sin. And so they're accepting it within the confines of their denomination, where they're even ordaining homosexual pastors and leaders. And right now, this year, and maybe next year, there are major conferences of denominations that are coming forth, and this is coming up for a vote. It's been voted down in the past before the pandemic, had been voted down, but they're seeing right now that there's a very strong possibility that now that it's going to go through. So the question is, where do we stand? Where do we stand? Where do those pastors that are part of that denomination, where are they standing? Will they continue? And people that are part of those denominations that are sitting in the pew, are they going to continue? Because by sitting in the pew and saying nothing and doing nothing is the same thing as approving it. Amen. This is something that those in Canada now have before them. We need to pray for them. We need to pray for the churches in Canada. Recently, a bill was passed, I am told, unanimously, both in the Senate and the House of Commons, that condemns trying to convert somebody back from a lifestyle of homosexuality and transgenderism. It's called the conversion theory. And the bill is aptly named C4. So I'm wondering when it's going to blow up in their face. But it's so broad in its scope, and I was reading a lot of it. It's so broad in its scope. Let me tell you where it's going to go. It's going to go to this. It's going to go to the pulpit. And if a pastor is going to preach against sin, specifically the sin of homosexuality or transgenderism or all the rest of those LBG... Yeah, I can't remember all the letters. And then tell people to repent and to turn away from them. That is going to be against this law. And they could be found guilty in a court of law by this bill. It's already passed, by the way. And basically, if found guilty, they could serve up to 5 years in prison for it. And let me tell you this, you know, Canada has already imprisoned pastors. They already imprisoned those people that will not follow their agenda. There's a warning that has been given. Either we are for Jesus or we are not, or we are against him. There is no middle ground in our faith. And so oftentimes we're taking middle ground as to not to, I don't want to shake anything up. And understand this, I'm not talking against a person here. I'm not talking against people. It's about a sin. And by the way, we're all sinners. Sorry, but I know that some people, but there is. We don't have to remain in that sin. We can repent and move from it. There's a warning that has been given. But if we fail to speak God's warning, then we're just as guilty as those who practice the sin itself. Now look at what the Lord says to these watchmen. And this is where I want to go to. Now this is found in verse 6. It's not going to be up on your screen. I didn't get it up there. I apologize. But verse 6 says this. But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet, and the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity. But then he says this. But his blood I'm going to require at the watchman's hand. He's making us responsible. Now, I want to take a broader look at this area of warning that has been given and whether or not it has been taken. In verse 5, it says, and if they had listened to the warning, they would have saved their lives. But at the same time, let's not forget what happens when they refuse to listen and not take the warning. In verse 4, if those who hear the alarm refuse to take action, it's their own fault if they die. To take a warning means to listen intently to what is being said. Because what is being said becomes a matter of life and death. For you see, God set before the people a choice, a blessing or curses, through the keeping or not keeping of his word, found in Deuteronomy 30, if you want to take some time and read that chapter. Jeremiah was a faithful prophet, even knowing the outcome. He even knew the outcome of what God was warning the people of. He knew the outcome of him speaking this forth. He knew it, and he still spoke up. It says, hear the word which the Lord speaks to you, O house of Israel. He already knew they were going to reject it. God already told them they were going to reject it, but still he was faithful to preach it. Jesus, in his parable of the seed and the soils, talks about four different types of soils. The first three was, and all these soils represented a person's heart once they hear God's word. Now, the first three were hearts that were either hardened, fearful, or feared with the cares of the world. And it says that God's word never made an impact upon them. But the fourth heart was open and receptive to hear God's word. And it says that it produced a bountiful harvest from his heart. So God gives us this warning. How we respond tells God the genuineness of our faith. How we respond. Because Jesus said, when I return, am I even going to find faith? I'd like to use a parable here of the 10 virgins as an example about what I've just been talking about. The fact that he calls them virgins means that they are believers in Jesus Christ. Or it could be the church itself. In other words, as believers in Christ, we are the bride waiting for Jesus, who is the bridegroom. Now here's the tale of the tape. Out of the 10 virgins, 5 are ready. 5 are ready to go. The other 5 have allowed their lamps to burn out and are not prepared. The 5 that were ready, all of a sudden the bridegroom comes, and those 5 go with him. The other 5 did not go. They come later, and they're sitting there knocking at the door. Let us in. And from the inside of the door, Jesus says, depart from me. I never knew you. What gets to me is this, is that this is the church. Half of the church, of the known church today, is going to go. The other half is not. The warning has been given. Jesus gave the warning. And so this leads me to the last area, and that is the deliverance achieved. I love the deliverance that they achieved. If they took God's warning in Ezekiel 33:5, again, look at that with me. If they listened to the warning, they could have saved their lives. Listen to some of God's promises of our salvation when we take God's warning. In Isaiah 43:25, he says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I'll not remember your sins. In Romans 3:24-25, the Apostle Paul said, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ, whom God set forth as a propitiation. That word propitiation means a sacrifice for sins. A propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance, God had passed over the sins that were previously committed. And Jesus said, most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. And so when we heed God's warning of what he is saying in his word, through the faithful preachers and teachers of his word, through the leading of the Holy Spirit, then as we looked at last week, we are no longer slaves, prisoners, or captives to sin. Instead, we are free, children of light, and prisoners of hope. For we make that choice to heed God's warning and then to receive the forgiveness of sins. That is when we will pass from this, when we pass from this existence into eternity. We won't hear the Lord say, depart from me, I never knew you. Instead, we're going to hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. And in the end, we'll participate in the promise of the rapture. As the Apostle Paul said, that the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we that are alive and remaining shall be caught up in the air with him, to be with him forever. And so as Jesus said, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. And so the warning has been given that outside of relationship with Jesus Christ, sin and death are what await. Go back to what the Apostle Paul said, Romans 3:23 and 6:23. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and that the wages of sin is death. The warning now being taken can be seen in what Jesus said when he goes to one of the most famous verses, most people know it. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him, there is the warning that has been taken. They took the warning, whoever believes in him, thus we got to the deliverance achieved, shall not perish but have everlasting life. And I love what he says when it says, so the wages of sin is death. There's your warning, the deliverance is the fact that, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So how do we prepare ourselves? How are we to prepare ourselves? First, pray. Pray. Spend time daily in prayer, seeking after God. Second, get into God's word. Read God's word. Study God's word. Hosea 4:6 says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. The Lord's going to reveal many things. When we get into his word, he's going to reveal to us how we are to live this life, the direction that he wants us to go in. Then we are to assemble with believers. Hebrews 10:25 says, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as the manner of some, but even more so as we are to exhort one another, even more so as we see the day approaching. We need to gather together because this is where we get that exhortation. We need to readjust our priorities. Jesus gives us that word when he said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things shall be added to you. We got to quit looking to everything else, trying everything else, trying to make life work. Instead, we are to seek God and his kingdom. We are to seek his righteousness first and foremost. Then he will do the rest of it. He's given us the warning. This is what we are to do. This is who we are to seek first. And finally, we are to share the gospel. Now, if you've been joining in these last several weeks, what I've made clear is that before the good news of Jesus Christ can be heard and followed, humanity must first be warned of the eternal danger that they are in. That's probably why I'm on this particular subject today. We forget to warn people. God has made us all into watchmen. We all are responsible to warn the people of what to expect. Because this life is only so long. Eternity is after this life. Our responsibility is to let the people know. And so we need to share that good news. You say, well, is that warning is good news? You betcha it's good news. Because it's going to tell us where we're going if we don't listen. And what's available to us when we do. That is heaven and eternity in the presence of the Lord God himself. So the warning's been given. Has the warning been taken? Understand this, when it's taken, a deliverance is going to be achieved. As I was sitting back there, the Lord's just laying on my heart that, you know what? God has given us all a warning. Every one of us. Have we heard it? Have we listened? Will we take the warning? Do something about it. Will we take the warning? That's our choice. What is God saying to you? I really would love for you guys today just to look inside and say, you know, what is God? What has God been saying to me? It's like what Sharon had done when she came up here. God spoke to her, gave her a vision. I didn't put that in her any way, shape, and or form. He gave a warning. Question is, was the warning going to be taken? And is that deliverance going to be achieved? But he's done that for each and every one of your lives. Just bow your head for a second. What is the warning God has given to you? What is that warning? Now determine in your heart today, right now, that you are going to listen, that you're going to obey. You're going to follow what it is that he's saying. And understand this, you can't do it on your own. That's where you need the Holy Spirit, that he would strengthen you during this time. So Heavenly Father, I want to ask you right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God, that you would do this within the hearts and lives of every person that is here, that we would take your warning, and Lord, that we would move forward and do what you have called us to do, to be who you have called us to be, no longer playing games, because the days are getting short. And that's what you were saying as you kept taking me back to the warnings of the last days. The days are getting short. We don't know how long we are going to have, how long we have left. And so right now, Lord, I ask that you would prepare the hearts of each and every person in here right now. Prepare their hearts to accept that which you have done and that which you are giving. If you are here today and you've never given your heart and life to Jesus Christ, you've never become born again, asking Jesus to be your Savior and Lord, he has told us, unless one is born again, they cannot see the kingdom of heaven. And he said, I am the only way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. And so if that is your prayer, ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart and into your life to be your Savior and Lord. To do that new work inside of you, where you become that new creation in him, where all the old things are passed away and everything becomes brand new. That is his promise. That if we take the warning, then that is the deliverance that we can receive. Jesus said one more thing. He said, if you accept me before others, I'll accept you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. And so if that is your prayer this morning, doesn't matter who's here, as we're praying at this point, our heads are bowed, we're praying, we're seeking what God is saying to us individually, but maybe God has been saying that to you, then right now, let there be a point of recognition and just raise your hand to God and say, yeah, that's me. I want to accept Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. Is there anyone here today that you want to give your heart and life to Jesus? Today is the day. Doesn't matter how long you've gone to church for or anything else. It's about your relationship with Jesus Christ. Is there anyone at all? God bless. And maybe you are here today as well. And you've been playing games. You've been back and forth. Not following the way you know you should have been following. Not taking those warning signs. Then right now, just commit before the Lord God. And say yes to him. Say yes to Jesus. Quit walking the middle line. and walk fully in the kingdom of God, where there's life forever. And so, Lord, I ask that you would go before each and every person that is here today, that you would do that good work, a work that only you can do. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would just minister that in the lives of every person. And I ask this in the name that is above all names. Father, I ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Okay, so we're going to dismiss the service when Pastor says, but we'll put this blessing before you. Please sing along. The Lord bless thee,
Lord bless thee.
And keep thee.
The
Lord make his face to shine upon thee. The Lord bless thee. And keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. And be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up,
Lord lift up
his countenance.
His
on thee and give thee peace.
God, that peace that passes all understanding, be yours today. And remember to shine the light of Jesus everywhere you go. Because not only is Jesus the light of the world, but he said, you are also the light, as you sign his light. Amen? God, have a great rest of your day. And thanks for all your prayers. If there's, our prayer teams are up here. If you would like, please come on down. Allow them to pray for you. And we'll go from there.
Don't forget to look at the sign-up sheet for Michaela.